Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Discovering the True Self, Kodo Sawaki's Art of Zen Meditation, by Kodo Sawaki. Translated, edited, and with an introduction by Arthur Braverman. Narrated by David Shih. All of Buddhism is a footnote to zazen. Kodo Sawaki. Prologue. Two Sawakis. Kosho Uchiyama, the late abbot of Antaiji Temple, often quoted from the talks of his teacher, Kodo Sawaki. Sawaki was renowned for translating obscure Buddhist terms into everyday language. It's not surprising that Uchiyama, after studying with Sawaki for over 25 years, would have acquired his teacher's talent for clarity and simplicity. Uchiyama remarked on more than one occasion that Kodo Sawaki had charisma, and added that sometimes his charisma could become an obstacle to people understanding what Uchiyama referred to as the Buddhist Sawaki. I believe what Uchiyama was referring to as the Buddhist Sawaki was the wisdom his teacher imparted that was not something based on a particular time and place. A teaching that transcended the culture and customs of Japan at the time. So what was this charisma to which Uchiyama referred? In 1973, I married the daughter of a Jodo Shin, true Pure Land Buddhist priest. Jodo Shin Buddhism is a faith-only sect of Buddhism, where priests have had families since back in the days of its founder, Shinran, in the 13th century. After the shock of giving up his heir, my father-in-law decided to take me to hear a sermon of a famous Jodo Shin priest by the name of Kikuchi. Reverend Kikuchi was 90 years old and still quite healthy. Since his daughter wasn't going to marry a Jodo Shin Buddhist priest, I guess my father-in-law thought he would at least indoctrinate me to their family religion. There were two priests giving sermons that night, Reverend Kikuchi and a Jodo priest whose name I don't remember. The Jodo priest spoke first. His talk was not very stimulating. When it was Reverend Kikuchi's turn, from the beginning, he created an atmosphere of friendly openness. He talked about why he was able to live so long, eat no more than 80% of what you would like to eat, and then told a few anecdotes having little to do with religion. Once his audience was relaxed, he added bits of Jodo Shin philosophy into his talk. He had everyone's attention. Because Japanese is not my native language, I got tired of trying to follow every word, and my mind started to wander. I looked around at the faces of people glued to the priest's every word, their heads slightly bobbing in assent, and some lips moving quietly. They were mostly older people, more women than men. As Kikuchi spoke, quoting the old masters, I could hear voices reciting, "Namu Amida Buddha." I take refuge in Amida Buddha. The priest became more animated as he spoke, and the voices of the choir of Namu Amida Buddha rose accordingly. By the end of the talk, it sounded like I imagined a revival meeting in the south would sound, with people losing their self-consciousness, inspired by voices from within. Was this Kikuchi's charisma? When we returned to my father-in-law's temple, I told my wife what I'd experienced. She explained that before all the new forms of entertainment, movies, TV, and theater, were available, temples were the places where people went for amusement. If there was no entertaining religious theater at that time, it would be left to the priest to make the evening enjoyable. That was where charisma became a plus for drawing crowds to the temples. This was particularly true of Jodo Shin temples, where Kodo Sawaki often went as a child. Part 1. The Life. Kodo Sawaki was raised in a town called Ishinden that had been formed around a major Jodo Shin temple, Senjuji. The town was divided into two zones, an inner and an outer. The inner zone was enclosed by a moat surrounding Senjuji, whose head priest ruled the town. The outer zone, outside the moat, where Sawaki lived, was developed after the inner zone and comprised mostly shady businesses like gambling parlors and brothels. After Saikichi, Sawaki's given name, lost both parents, he was passed on to an uncle who died soon after the boy moved in with him, and then was adopted by an associate of another uncle. His new adoptive father was a lantern maker who turned his house into a gambling parlor at night. His adoptive mother was a retired prostitute. They adopted the young Saikichi so that they could put him to work for them. If the boy did something wrong, his stepfather would beat him, and if he did not behave properly at home, his stepmother would hit him on the head with the bowl side of her lit pipe. Saikichi was a tough street kid, and when he reached his teens, he no longer feared his stepfather. But he still felt like he was suffocating in this squalor created by his adoptive family and their friends, and he decided to run away. During his last year with his step-parents, he visited many temples in the neighborhood, all true Pure Land temples. He already had a gift for storytelling as a child, and if there were any charismatic priests in Ishinden, when he was searching for answers to his dilemma at that time, they would have made a lasting impression on him. His experiences while living in Ishinden were a mixture of hard work, fighting to survive, which he seemed to have little difficulty with, and a growing interest in the religious life. He had once, as a child, seen a group of monks return to their temple after being out begging and reciting a Buddhist chant, and the peace he felt as he watched these monks contrasted with his present wretched condition. He never forgot it. Saikichi ran away from his home in Ishinden, deciding to go to Eiheiji Monastery. It was a 3-day trip. Though he arrived half-starved, he was elated. A monk at the gate tried to send him away, but he refused to leave. He said he would die rather than go back home. After sitting by the gate to the monastery for 2 days, famished and disheveled, a monk in charge of the temple laborers took pity on him and allowed him to stay in the workers' quarters. "From before I was old enough to remember," Sawaki said at one of his sermons, "my sister told me I was always getting into trouble. She said it was the biggest concern of my mother when she was on her deathbed. I was 3 years old at the time." His mother felt his father was too easy on him and wouldn't be able to control him once she was gone. Not much is known about Saikichi's birth father, other than that he was a gentle man, and, according to Saikichi's sister, her brother was always calm in his presence. This was a boy she described as the neighborhood terror. When his father died, he was placed in the guardianship of his aunt and uncle. Though his uncle treated him as an unwanted orphan who was nothing but another mouth to feed, Saikichi was still relatively happy to have a home. He would take his young spoiled cousin to a nearby temple where the neighborhood kids played. When the monks from the temple came back from their begging round, they would chant as they entered the temple. The young Saikichi was moved by the sense of calm he felt as the monks chanted in unison. It was a feeling he hadn't experienced since his time in the presence of his father. Saikichi's time in Ishinden, where he was sent after the sudden death of his uncle, was a mixture of hopelessness in the presence of his adoptive parents and glimmers of a hopeful world when he visited a neighbor, Chiaki Morita, a young art student who invited Saikichi into his family's home. When Saikichi observed his neighbor's cultured home and the respect the family members showed each other, he realized not everyone lived a wretched life like his adoptive family and their friends. He knew then that he had to escape. Sawaki tells this story in one of his sermons. "When I was 9 years old, a man of about 50 died in the midst of sleeping with a prostitute young enough to be his granddaughter. It created quite a stir in the neighborhood. There were policemen, detectives, and a crowd of pedestrians gathered around the brothel. The grown-ups were taking turns peeking inside and gossiping about what they thought had happened. I was extremely quick then, so I used my power to maneuver between people's legs and made my way through the entrance and up to the second floor. We used to play hide and seek in the rooms up there, so I knew my way around and thought nothing of going in and out of the rooms on that floor. That's when I saw the dead man lying on a futon and a young woman of about 17 or 18 years old, a prostitute in her bathrobe, plopped down by the pillow, looking unconcerned. Next to the corpse was a woman I assumed to be the dead man's wife, who probably had been called and who was wailing and holding on to him and grumbling. "Oh, you. Dying on me like this is one thing, but here of all places, it will cause a scandal." Sawaki goes on to say that the incident gave him a feeling of emptiness that was stronger than anything he'd felt when his mother, father, or uncle died. "I also realized," he added, "that you can't really hide anything. Not only on the day her husband died, but for all the occasions after, from the funeral to the 1-year, 3-year, and 7-year memorials, people will be saying, 'He's the one who died on the second floor of that whorehouse in the midst of doing it.'" Though Saikichi had a sense of right and wrong, and realized that Ishinden was a place where there was much seediness, his relationship with the Moritas and his later trips to the Pure Land temples in the neighborhood showed him that there was also a world of beauty somewhere out there, and he hoped to be a part of that world. Despite those feelings, it would be a long time before the boy, who wouldn't hesitate to use his fist to settle disputes, would find a calm place either inside him or in the outside world. At this point in the young Saikichi's life, he knew nothing of Zen Buddhism. If we think in terms of Zen's principle of inherent Buddha nature, we can look at his development as a series of confirmations of a truth inherent already in his being. One came from a sermon at one of the Shin Buddhist temples when he made the round of temples in Ishinden. That sermon inspired him to go to Eheji with very little money or food. In Sawaki's words, "I clearly remember one sermon at a Pure Land temple when I lived in Ishinden. It was about Sessan Doji, who was willing to throw away his life to hear the second half of a poem pointing to the truth. When Sessan Doji lived in the snow mountains, the Himalayas, Tentai Shaku, a god who protects the earth, took the form of Rasetsu, a flesh-eating demon, and appeared in front of Sessan and recited these two verses. 'All things are impermanent. They appear and disappear.' Upon hearing these words, Sessan was elated. 'Let me hear the rest of the poem. If you do, I will be your disciple,' he said. 'I know the following verses,' Rasetsu said, 'but I am famished and can't say another word.' Sessan couldn't bear not hearing the final verses and said, 'If you recite the verses for me, I will let you eat my flesh.' The demon then said, 'Put an end to appearance and disappearance. Nirvana is realized.' Sessan proceeded to carve the verses on trees, rocks, and roads, and then climbed a tall tree and was about to jump to his death when Tentai Shaku turned back into his original form and caught him. Sessan Doji was said to be Shakyamuni Buddha in a previous life. I didn't know the details of this talk at the time, but this young way seeker being willing to throw away his life to hear the true Dharma moved me greatly." He thought he'd found the true Dharma when he arrived at Eheji Monastery and would be able to settle down there. But it turned out not to be that simple. After working for a while with the temple laborers, he was told by a monk that he would not be able to stay indefinitely. Eiheiji does not ordain, a monk he worked with told him. You have to find a temple where you can be ordained, and then, with a request from that teacher, you can return to Eiheiji. Sawaki talked about his feelings when he first arrived at Eiheiji, how he felt all the monks he saw were bodhisattvas. Then he met monks who promised him ordination if he went to their home temples. That was the beginning of his awareness that not every monk was a bodhisattva. One, in particular, was for him a real trickster. One monk, who was caretaker at his teacher's temple, Chojuan in Maruoka, Echizen, said, "If you come to my temple, I'll see to it you're ordained." I was elated. Anything to allow me to be ordained, I thought. I happily went to his teacher's temple. However, he turned out to be shrewd in the worldly sense, but also a very lazy, degenerate monk. Under the guise of seeing that I would become a monk, his ulterior motive was to use me like a maid, working me to the bone. I wore old work clothes and worked myself ragged. In the morning, I'd fill up 3 buckets of water, read morning sutras, prepare rice gruel, and then do winter austerities. This was in the middle of the coldest time of the year, and 5 in the morning. I did takuhatsu, begging, barefooted on the northern country's snow-covered road. After exhausting myself in this way, I'd come back to find that lazy, good-for-nothing monk drinking sake with a woman. I realized that he sent me on takuhatsu so I wouldn't be around to see his misbehavior. Nevertheless, I continued devotedly to do the work without any complaints. However, that silly monk took me for a weakling. He would constantly berate me. One day, he was drinking with a woman and picking at pieces of meat and yelling abuses at me. I grabbed him and dragged him from the parlor into the snow and beat him mercilessly. I pushed his face into the snow and I walked away from the temple and returned to Eiheiji. When I think about that time in my life and how miserable I was, tears come to my eyes. At that time, however, I didn't feel regret at all. Before Sawaki left Eiheiji Monastery to find a temple where he would finally be ordained, he was introduced to the practice of zazen by one of his fellow monks. He knew nothing of the practice before entering Eiheiji, knew nothing of Zen. He only knew, as a result of counsel from a Pure Land priest in Ishinden, that Pure Land priests were expected to marry and raise families. The priest told him that having a wife and children would make serious practice difficult, if not impossible. "I visited Eiheiji on my travels," the priest said, "and it was a place where genuine Buddhist practice prevailed. I would recommend you go to Eiheiji." "If you're going to be a Zen monk," an Eiheiji friend told him, "you have to learn how to practice zazen." The only thing the young Saikichi knew about zazen was a feeling like an electric shock going through him at the mere sight of the silhouette of 4 monks sitting in meditation on the other side of a screen when he went into the storage room to get some sugar for the temple cook. He walked quietly past the screen, feeling that what those monks were doing was a holy act. After the first lesson by the monk, he sat in zazen every chance he had. On one occasion, Saikichi went with a group of Eiheiji monks to assist at a ceremony at Ryu-unji Temple. Ryu-unji was a temple connected to Eiheiji. Saikichi was 17 years old and still only a worker and not ordained. When the ceremony was over, the monks had some free time, so they went out to have fun. Saikichi, having become very serious about understanding zazen to its depth, remained behind and sat in zazen facing one of the sliding screens in one of the tatami-matted floors in a temple reception room. A woman who volunteered to help at the temple and had a tendency to boss Saikichi around happened to walk in on him while he was practicing zazen. Sawaki tells this story many years later on an NHK broadcast called Religion Time. "I was practicing zazen when this maid, who came to help with the food preparation, was cleaning the bowls, reciting, 'Praise the Buddha, praise the Dharma.' She opened the sliding screen door to put the bowls away and saw me practicing zazen. With a gasp, she bowed to me in prayer pose. At that time, I hadn't studied anything about Buddhism and knew nothing about the philosophy of zazen. This was a woman who ordered me around and now bowed to me as if I were a Buddha. Without a doubt, there must be something to this practice. I felt then that zazen was something I should do all my life. I was 17, and it was the end of the Obon festival. At some time during his stay at Eheji, someone called Saikichi Tetsugen, and the name stuck. The last few months at Eheji, he'd been called Tetsugen, the name having the ring of a monk. Tetsugen was on the road. Destination, Shoshinji Temple in Amakusa, Kyushu. A student of Kōhō Sawada Roshi, who was training at Eheji, had befriended Sawaki and convinced him to go to Shoshinji, where he was sure his teacher would ordain him. Sawaki had no money, but his robe, though tattered, and his shaved head allowed him to stay the night at temples willing to accommodate him, and many would send him off the next morning with a box lunch. The hike from Eheji was arduous, but Sawaki was strong and determined. The hike across the country was the least of his problems. Not everyone he met believed he was a student of Buddhism. His ragged condition made some suspect he was a criminal disguised as a monk. When he came to the Kuzuryu River, he would have to take a ferry across. Without a penny to his name, he joined the crowd and boarded the boat. When they reached the other shore, the captain came around to collect the fee. Tetsugen had to think quickly. He started reciting the Heart Sutra, stretching the recitation as long as he could, keeping his head down so he wouldn't make contact with the captain. "When the ferry emptied out, and it was only myself and the crew," Sawaki said, "I finally looked up at the captain and told him of my plight. I recited this sutra to help all sentient beings to enter the Buddha land, and the fact is, I have no money." I was panicking inside. "Please accept this recitation in lieu of the fee." The captain looked down at me and laughed and allowed me to go. Sawaki took this as a good omen and continued on his way with a new bounce in his step, reciting sutras out loud and doing takuhatsu on the road. He gave the appearance of someone full of confidence. In his own words, however, "I was not cheerful inside. My pocket was empty, and the cold was severe." Crossing mountains in the snow with bare feet, he contracted frostbite. He realized he could never make it all the way to Kyushu like that, so he went to his older sister Sai's place. Sai and her husband had a fish store in Iga Ueno, a town famous as the home of ninja warriors and the birthplace of the poet Basho. When his sister saw him, he was so dirty she thought he was a beggar. When she realized it was her long-lost brother, they hugged. She screamed and pushed him away. He was full of lice. She made him take off all of his clothes and put them in a bucket of boiling water. Until then, Sawaki hadn't realized he was so full of lice. He reflected on how troublesome it must have been for all the temples he stopped at during his trek from Eheji. "At that time, I was smothered in lice. From the time I left Eheji until I reached my sister's place, I had stayed in many temples on the way. I guess there was a big commotion at all those temples after I left, One I remember in particular was a Pure Land temple that took me in for the night and fed me. They asked me if I could repaper their shoji sliding doors. Having worked fixing paper lanterns at Ishinden, it was an easy job for me. The priest of the temple was impressed with my work and asked me to stay on for a few days, giving me special treatment. And what did I leave him in return? A temple full of lice. Sawaki stayed with his sister and brother-in-law until his frostbite healed, reminiscing with his sister about their lives as children. She took him around and showed him the sights of Iga Ueno. His brother-in-law tried to convince him to stay on permanently and work for them, but Sawaki was determined to become an ordained monk. He even refused to eat the fish they offered him. Once back on the road, moving down from the mountains, the warmth made traveling easier. But it wasn't long before disaster hit again. Sawaki boarded a ferry from Otsu to Kobe. One of the passengers, a woman of about 22 or 23 years old, who sat right in front of Sawaki, couldn't find her purse and created a big commotion about it. In Sawaki's words, "Of all the passengers on board, I had the dirtiest outfit and was immediately suspect. I would never do anything like stealing," I said. "I came from Eheiji Monastery and am on my way to Amakusa to continue my religious practice. It's true that I am poor, but I wouldn't steal even if my life depended on it." When he got off the boat, a few policemen were waiting for him. They took him to the Kobe Minakami prison, disregarding his pleas of innocence, and threw him in a cell and locked him in. "No matter what I said in my defense," Sawaki said, looking back on this experience years later, "they were convinced that I was a thief, and that was that." He only spent a month in prison and was eventually released at the request of a prison chaplain who believed his story. He was still a teenager at the time and felt that the world was coming to an end. But on reflection, he said that the experience came in handy when, as a mature Buddhist priest, he gave talks to prisoners. "They trusted me because I could tell them of my own experience of being incarcerated." Sawaki talked about his prison experience as being positive for the knowledge he received from it, but that wasn't what he felt when it was happening to him. "No matter how much I cried and cursed my fate," he said, "it did no good." His description of his period of incarceration was not without humor. He described how the apparent leader of a group of tough prisoners approached him and asked what he was in for.
"Hey, little monk, what did you do to get yourself in here?" the boss man with his frightening frown asked. "I was slouched over in the corner feeling very small. Actually, someone on the same theory as me misplaced some money, and I was blamed for it, so I was thrown in here."
"So how much did you get?"
"Oh no, I didn't steal anything. But still, I was treated like this," I said, as if I were pleading my case in court.
"You stupid bastard," the boss man said. "We are murderers, arsonists, rapists, robbers, and there are many who haven't been caught still running loose. And you're in this place saying you didn't steal anything? What are you, an idiot?"
Sawaki went on to talk about how the prisoners made lives for themselves behind bars.
"They would take a clump of rice and squeeze it until it was hard and solid, and then carve it into a cube. Then they would take a piece of broken straw and poke indents in each of the six sides to create dice. Since there was nothing inside the prison that they could gamble with, they'd use the rice dice and bet with the only currency they had, their meals. They couldn't state their bets out loud because the guards would come and break up the game, so they quietly put up fingers indicating their bets. Some bet a meal, some two meals,
and the cautious ones would bet a pickle. They were totally involved in the game. The big losers would go without food, some for a whole day. If they lost all their meals, they just sat quietly watching the game.
In reflecting on his short incarceration, he came to the conclusion that life inside the prison was not that much different than the lives of those men who lived in the outside world.
From the Buddhist point of view, he reflected, we are all originally deluded beings.
So he did not see a great difference between the prisoners and the prison guards. After his release from prison, thanks to the chaplain, his trip to Shoshinji in Amakusa went relatively smoothly. He arrived at the temple in the spring of the 30th year of Meiji, 1897, and was ordained by Kōhō Sawada Roshi the following 8th of December, the traditional date for the Buddha's enlightenment. Sawaki's relationship with Sawada Roshi, the abbot of Shōshinji, and with many of the people in the temple community was one of mutual respect. He was 18 years old when he arrived, a rash young novice, energetic and willing to do whatever was needed in order to reach his goal of being ordained as a Zen Buddhist monk. The abbot paid careful attention to the goings-on at the temple and to the lives of his disciples. The new novice's energy did not go unnoticed. He took Sawaki under his wing, teaching him what the abbot was known for, reading sutras in a powerful and sonorous voice. Sawaki had a powerful voice, but a lot to learn before he could channel that voice into the proper pitch, rhythm, and tonal variation required to chant sutras. Sawada Roshi pushed his young disciple until he was satisfied that Sawaki had learned to make proper use of his sutra reciting voice. Many years later, when Sawaki described his time at Shoshinji, he praised the abbot. The priest, Kōhō Sawada's calligraphy was highly skillful. His voice was outstanding, and his tone and melody when chanting sutras was first class. In addition, he composed poetry. In Sawaki's first 6 months at Shōshinji, along with learning how to project his voice to chant sutras, he learned how to perform Buddhist ceremonies. He was not only given special treatment by the master, but he became very popular among the parishioners. According to Sawaki, many parishioners made specific requests to Sawada Roshi to allow him to come to their houses to chant sutras at their altars for the memorials of their departed. All this favoritism did not go over well with the other monks. Koun Yamamoto, the young monk who befriended Sawaki at Eheji, had recommended to Sawaki that he go to Shōshinji to finally get ordained. He told Sawaki that his teacher, Sawada Roshi, was an authentic Zen master, and that Sawaki wouldn't be disappointed when he studied under Sawada. He was convincing enough to get his young friend to travel halfway across the country to study at Shōshinji. After a year training at Eheji, Yamamoto returned to Shōshinji. Sawaki was excited to tell Yamamoto that he had indeed been ordained and that Sawada Roshi was everything Yamamoto had said about him. To Sawaki's surprise, however, Yamamoto was very cold to him. He started to boss Sawaki around and cursed him when he made mistakes, even striking him at times. Sawaki passively took it all, hoping that his older brother disciple would change once he settled back in Shōshinji. In Sawaki's words, since I didn't strike back at Koun, he must have thought he could easily take advantage of me. Not knowing Sawaki's past, Yamamoto had no idea how explosive his Dharma brother could be. Yamamoto's change in attitude toward Sawaki was at least partly due to the younger disciple's popularity with their teacher. Sawaki was to learn jealousy was not something that only existed outside of Buddhist temples. Sawaki being the newcomer, Yamamoto probably figured he could do whatever he wanted to his younger brother disciple, and Sawaki would have to take it. That was, after all, the protocol at Zen monasteries. He was to learn that it wasn't always so. The major confrontation came during the Seigaki ceremony. Sawaki described it as follows.
The villagers came to help in the kitchen with the food preparation. I dropped something, and Koen hit me with a fire shovel. That was the last straw. What the hell do you think you're doing? I screamed. I grabbed his feet and threw him down and beat him severely. Then I took his fundoshi, loincloth, tied him up with it, and dumped him in a mud puddle. Everyone stopped what they were doing, but nobody tried to stop me. They knew Koen had been picking on me and were pretty disgusted with his behavior. They seemed ready to back me up. I heard someone say, I thought Kodo was just a nice guy, but he finally fought back. And many applauded me. Sawada Roshi entered the kitchen and supported me, saying, Kodo bore it as much as he could, and finally let it all out. Koen Yamamoto fell out of favor, even with the teacher.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.